Yesterday, we discussed at length about all the things that we have to discuss and think about when we are preparing an arbitration clause or an arbitration agreement. And unfortunately, I exceeded the time. So we'll be picking up from where we left yesterday. Now, the first thing that comes to your mind when a client comes to you saying that there is a problem. You identify that there is an arbitration clause in the agreement. Obviously, that's the first thing that you would mostly do. And apart from reading the contract itself and understanding the parties' rights and obligations, the client will ask you, okay, what kind of relief that I can get at this point of time? Because commencing arbitration and undergoing or experiencing the arbitration process itself. It will take some time to kickstart and then go through, etc. So the first thing that would come to your mind is to think if the client requires any interim reliefs or any urgent reliefs so that your client's rights are not violated or otherwise, affected in an adverse manner. So moving on to the next slide, we will discuss the reliefs that we can get from the court. So if we can just go to the next slide. So now the Arbitration Act under Section 9 provides that before, during, and after the arbitration is over, before you enter under Section 36 in accordance with Section 36, parties are free to approach the court and request for interim reliefs. Now let's take an example where I am a financier. Okay, my client is a financing company, and my client gives out a loan to another person in order to buy certain vehicles. The vehicles that are bought from these funds that I have loaned out are hypothecated to me, which means that I have a charge on those vehicles. The agreement provides that in case I consider that there is a breach, then I will enforce my hypothecation, I will enforce my charge. I will take possession of those vehicles, I will sell those vehicles, and then I will appropriate that sum towards the outstanding amount, the amount that has not been paid back to me. So when the client approaches me, the client says that I have provided such and such loan, and there was a period of time in which the installments were required to be paid along with interest. This respondent, I'll call that person the respondent. The respondent has not paid the installment, the principal amount, or the interest, and the loan has now become entirely repayable at once. Now, this respondent is staying in Haryana. I am in Bombay. My client is also in Bombay. My client does not have an office in Haryana, and he or she does not have people in Haryana otherwise who can take quick action, and even if legally authorized. So couple of things that will come to your mind. One is that your client has the right to take possession of the vehicles, and two is that there is an apprehension that the other side, you don't know, the other side or the respondent may be running out of funds, and that is the reason why that person has not paid your client back, or for that reason that the respondent may sell off those vehicles and appropriate the sums to him or her. If that happens, even if you go through the arbitration, it may turn out that, and if you get a favorable award also in your favor, even then, if the vehicles are sold and the respondent doesn't have any money left, the award will become a paper decree, which is to say that there is no point. Even if you go in execution proceedings, there is very little that you will be able to take out of it. So what you would do is, as a lawyer, you will first draft a Section 9 petition or an application, submit it to the court and request the court that an injunction, a temporary injunction, be provided against the respondent from selling or parting or otherwise alienating from the hypothecated vehicles. Those vehicles should not be sold. You will also ask for the respondent to deposit the outstanding amount as security with the court. You would also perhaps ask for a receiver. A receiver is an agent appointed by the court. The agent can be a court receiver, or as we will see later, it can be a private person who is appointed by the arbitral tribunal as well. But in Bombay High Court, the court has a court receiver, which is authorized by, it is under the aegis of the Bombay High Court. So when you apply to the Bombay High Court for a court receiver, the court receiver is given certain powers. So if you see, if I'm not wrong, Order 40 of the Civil Procedure Code, you will see the powers that have been granted to the receiver. What you will ask is for the receiver to physically go to Haryana to inspect the presence of the hypothecated vehicles, to take the vehicles into possession, and to construct in constructive as well as physical possession, so that your claim is secure. You can sell those vehicles and appropriate the amount, because that is your contractual right. And for the sum that is outstanding, that still remains, you can go for arbitration. When you are asking for security to be deposited in the court, which is your entire claim essentially, you would, that is a drastic measure. Think about it, because you are asking the other side to deposit the entire amount that you are otherwise supposed to receive after the entire arbitration is over. So you will have to make out a very compelling case, and the grounds for making out that case are set out in Order 38, Rule 5 of the Civil Procedure Code. Now, one would think that the CPC and Evidence Act, as we saw yesterday, do not apply to the arbitral tribunal in arbitral proceedings. However, if you see Section 9 of the Arbitration Act, it provides that the court will otherwise have all the powers that it has in other proceedings, which means that the CPC is applicable. They have to, even though the CPC by itself is not entirely applicable, the principles of the Civil Procedure Code are applicable. So you do have to make out a compelling case. The precedent for this you can find in BCCI versus Nimbus. It's a judgment of the Bombay High Court. Also a judgment of the Supreme Court in Arvind Constructions, where the Supreme Court has held that provisions of the Specific Relief Act will also apply. Or in principle, they will apply, not entirely. These cases we will share after the session is over in the chat. We will share it, or maybe thereafter. So seeking interim relief is one of the most important things before you commence your arbitration, if at all that is applicable. Once you have secured any interim relief, as you will see at the bottom of this slide, you have a period of 90 days or such other time that the court otherwise decides to commence the arbitration. You can't sit on interim relief and then forget about the claim. You have to commence arbitration. Otherwise, the other side, the respondent, will have the right to apply and seek the order to be vacated, which means that the order will be brushed aside. Now it will be taken back by the court, right? Let's go to the next part. Now, before commencing arbitration, one must understand that arbitration is commenced in accordance with whatever is laid down in Section 21. Once you issue the notice of arbitration, your limitation period comes to an end insofar as the claims are concerned. But before you do that, there are a couple of things that you should take into consideration. The limitation for the claims itself. Now, at the time that you are issuing the notice of arbitration, you should know whether your claims are falling within the period of limitation. Now, given that most arbitration disputes are commercial disputes, broadly, it would be a claim for damages, or it may be a claim for specific performance of the contract. So, or an injunction or a declaration also for that matter, but mainly damages or specific performance. In damages, when you're filing a suit for damages, you would know that under the Arbitration Act, the Limitation Act is applicable as well. So the same limitation periods which apply to suits and other applications are also applicable to arbitration claims. If I may just request everyone to be on mute, there is some disturbance. Thanks. So you have to consider the limitation periods in a suit for damages. It would be 3 years from the day that the contract was broken. In a suit for specific performance, it would again be a period of 3 years from the date of breach or when the performance was due. And in all residual cases, under Article 113 or 115, it provides also for 3 years from whenever the right has accrued. You also need to look at, as we discussed yesterday, the contractual requirements. While the position is unclear, it would always be advisable to go through whatever contractual requirements are there before commencing an arbitration. That could be a negotiation requirement or an escalation requirement, like we discussed yesterday. Sometimes when you are seeking damages, or rather when you are seeking damages on most times, it would be because you are terminating the contract. The parties have now come to a position where they can't take the relationship forward. So one of the parties is going to terminate the contract and seek damages. Okay. If they are seeking damages, then sometimes the contract provides that there has to be an opportunity that you give to the respondent before you entirely terminate the contract, which is most often described as a cure period, a defect cure notice, and a notice for a few days or a few months in which you give an opportunity to the respondent to cure the in that period of the defect is not cured, pre-dispute negotiation requirements. Parties are become completely impossible, or the respondent has taken such steps that would show that there is a repudiatory breach by the respondent. A repudiatory breach is that you can show that it's because of the respondent, it's the performance has become completely impossible, or the respondent has fully refused to and it would be a waste of time, it would be a liability on the claimant's rights. But this is something that would depend on the facts of every case. Lastly, one should also check the rules of an institution in case we are following any institutional rules, such as the MCI rules or the LCI rules. All of them provide for certain mandatory, formal and substantive requirements that you have to comply with in a notice of arbitration, and all of those should be covered. Now, given the paucity of time, I won't be checking into any particular rules. We can take a look at that later in some other session. So let's go to the next slide. So now we come to the issuance of the arbitration notice itself. Now it's a seemingly innocuous document. It doesn't have any particular weightage as such, because you will later on file the statement of claim. But it is a very important document when you're issuing, because that is your first formal correspondence that you would be issuing under the letterhead of the lawyer. First, obviously, you have to check the addressees. It seems like an obvious requirement, but you have to use the right address. And when I say the right address, most times contracts provide that notices, if any, should be issued to a particular person at a particular address. If that is not done, then the other side may have some kind of leeway to claim that I did not receive the notice at all. The subject, you would always specify that this is an arbitration notice for invocation of arbitration, so on and so forth. These are just directory requirements that I would suggest. Is you would also reference to, you would provide reference to all the agreements or the main agreement that you are referring to, under which your rights and obligations arise. The correspondence, if they have been exchanged by the parties, you need not go into specifying all the letters with all the dates, etc. You can probably, if there are too many, you can refer to just the parties' correspondence shared by the parties, so on and so forth. Then you start by saying, because now it's being issued on your letterhead, the law, letterhead of the lawyer or the law firm, saying that we are concerned for our client, so and so. Our client has instructed us to write to you as follows. Now, first thing, you will provide a factual background. Don't need to go into too much detail. What we essentially have to highlight is that there has been a transaction. There is a legal relationship. By entering into this transaction, the parties intended to achieve certain results. There was some kind of objective. Then under that agreement, we highlight what are the respondent's obligations that the respondent was supposed to comply with. And then we move on to say that among all these obligations that the respondent was supposed to comply with, these obligations the respondent has not complied with or has breached. You would also show that at all points of time, your client has in fact complied with all the obligations that your client was required to comply. Then you go on to show that the claimant or your client has at various points in time requested the respondent to comply with his or her obligations. But the respondent, despite all this correspondence, has failed in complying with these obligations. You may also set out that there have been attempts for settlement that are your client attempted to enter into settlement negotiations. There were various discussions that were entered into, but all of that was futile and the respondent still remains in breach. And that is why you have no other option and you are constrained to invoke the arbitration procedure under the contract. It would be helpful to refer to the particular clause, sometimes even set out the entire clause as per the requirements of the institutional rules or otherwise, of what the arbitration clause exactly is. And you set out that please treat this communication as a notice for commencement of arbitration in accordance with the requirements of Section 21 of the Arbitration Act. The arbitration clause, as we discussed yesterday, may decide or describe that it would be done by way of a single arbitrator, sole arbitrator, or three arbitrators, whatever procedure is required to be followed. In case you are required to nominate an arbitrator, you should propose your nomination at that point of time. Say that I am nominating so and so person as the arbitrator. And if it's a three-member arbitral tribunal, then you should request the other side to also nominate that person's arbitrator within a specified period of time. Failing which, your client will reserve the right to approach the court. And if the client is required to approach the court, that would be entirely at the respondent's risk as to the costs and consequences thereof. Now, this is a boilerplate line that everyone puts. The idea behind that is that because you are not performing with your obligations, I have to go to court and apply under Section 11 and request the appointment of an arbitrator. If I incur any costs or there are any other consequences, they will be borne by you. And eventually, you have to reserve your rights in, again, a boilerplate requirement, which says that whatever has been stated in this notice of arbitration is without prejudice to our client's rights and remedies under law, all of which remain reserved. Again, the reason is that this is an initiation document. Your full-fledged arguments and your position will all be set out in the statement of claim. Now, sometimes in arbitration rules, they provide that this notice of arbitration can be treated as a statement of claim. Depending on the facts of the case, you can derive if you want to make it completely exhaustive so that later on you are not going to file another separate statement of claim, or given the nature of the matter or the urgency, you can file a concise small notice of arbitration, and of course you will have the right to file a detailed statement of claim. Now, go to the next slide. So, in the notice of arbitration, what you are going to do, you are going to highlight all the breaches, right, of the other side. There is no requirement of you to go into an exhaustive list of the claims that you are going to submit before the arbitral tribunal. Because that is something that as I said, you will be able to do at the stage of filing your statement of claim. So it is, again, dependent on the facts and circumstances of the case, but always recommended, because you have a chance at the statement of claim stage, to make it a concise document, the notice of arbitration. Now, once you issue the notice of arbitration, alongside, you would also have to appoint your arbitrator. Now, in my understanding, the term appointment of arbitrator is rather misleading, because any clause that provides, whether it's a sole arbitrator or three-member tribunal, parties ideally would have the right to nominate any person. That person will then choose, first of all, whether she wants to be appointed as an arbitrator. And even after she chooses to be appointed as an arbitrator, there are certain requirements under the law, after compliance of which that person will eventually be appointed in law as the arbitrator. So you will issue a letter to whoever your nominee is and request that person to provide their consent to be appointed as an arbitrator. Once that person provides their consent, that person will also have to issue a declaration as per 12.6 of the Arbitration Act. There are certain disclosures that are required so that we ensure that the arbitrator is independent and impartial. There is no conflict of interest. The grounds for any conflict are set out in 12.5, 12.7, and you should also take a look at the 5th schedule and the 7th schedule of the Arbitration Act for conflict. As far as the disclosure are concerned, take a look at the 6th schedule on what exactly is required to be disclosed by the arbitrator. Now, once all these things are clear, there will be a request by the claimant for the first meeting. All correspondences that you have in the arbitration should ideally be marked to the other side, and so that everybody is on the same page to the other side as well as all arbitrators. Once the arbitration commences, you will have the first meeting where several ground rules, like we just decided for this session, there are some housekeeping rules, some ground rules that we are going to follow. So, and how we are going to take this arbitration forward. Remember, there is a requirement under Section 29A of the Arbitration Act that an arbitration has to be completed within a period of 12 months from the arbitrator's acceptance. Now that has been changed to 12 months from completion of pleadings, statement of claim and statement of defense. In any case, the tribunal will, in the first meeting, set out the constitution of the tribunal, set out the facts that on so and so date, the notice of appointment should be accepted. Then we made certain disclosures. There was no opposition from any of the parties. Then they will set out a schedule for all that has to be done by both the parties, which we'll see in the next slide. Then the parties may, or the tribunal may also set out, if at all, especially in an international arbitration, if there are any rules of evidence that they would like to follow, that they would like the parties to follow. Then there would be various other ancillary requirements, procedural directions, such as the manner of filing pleadings, the mode of filing. You have to file by email. You have to also provide physical copies. They should all be signed. They should be in A4 size. They should be double-sided. Scanned legible copies should be provided to all the parties. All correspondence should be marked to all the parties, including the arbitrators. No ex parte communications with the arbitrator, which means that without marking the other side, you can't correspond, whether by in writing or otherwise by picking up the phone call. You should not talk to the arbitrator without the knowledge of the other side. Then whatever service requirements are there, that the arbitral tribunal will also set out where the notices should be, so on and so forth. The tribunal may say that the examination in chief would have to be provided on sworn affidavits, which means that the affidavit will have to be notarized in accordance with whatever law is prevailing. No, this is not always the case. Sometimes the witness statement or affidavit of evidence is deemed to be complied with, even if it has a statement of truth or a verification. Which means, and which we will see later on, that the witness says, I verify everything that I have said above. The tribunal may also say that there will be a strict no-no on grant of extensions for no reason, only in exceptional circumstances because of the timelines. If the timelines are not followed, if any party is required to make a submission, or if a party is required to file and that party does not do that, then that party will deem to have waived their right to file that particular document or file that particular objection. So that the party cannot later on, at the stage of challenging the award, say that I was not given an opportunity to present my case. Okay. Lastly, the tribunal may also say that parties are always free to attempt any settlement, and because that is the most economical thing, honestly, is for parties to try and settle their disputes. Throughout the arbitration, they'll be spending a lot of time, money and effort. If they can come to some kind of a resolution, then always parties are free to do that. Tribunal will also set out the fees the quantum of fees that are required to be paid to the arbitrator and any administrative services that are being taken by the tribunal. In ad hoc arbitrations, there would be stenographers, there would be other expenditures, the arbitrators, travel expenses, etc. All that will be set out. If there is a three-member tribunal, the amount that is paid to the presiding arbitrator and the two other arbitrators, so on and so forth, the account to which this the money has to be transferred. Of course, in case of institutional arbitration, they always have a schedule and they have to follow strict to as per the claim, what amount has to be paid to the institution for administrative charges, for filing charges. All that is done in a very systematic manner. Then lastly, the tribunal may also declare in the procedural order itself that the venue for arbitration is at place A and the arbitral meetings will be held at so and so place. So a lot of times ad hoc arbitrations are held in hotels where they have conference rooms, and they also provide that parties will split the cost and both parties will have the right eventually to claim the cost in case the tribunal so decides. So moving on to the next slide. So this is just a sample schedule that I have prepared and shared with you on what kind of things the arbitral tribunal is going to ask both the parties to, starting with filing the statement of claim, then statement of defense. As you can see, what I mean by here 4 weeks and 2 weeks so and so is after each filing, after each prior filing, 4 weeks, 4 weeks, 2 weeks after that, so and so forth. So key things are filing of the pleadings, which is the statement of defense, rejoinder from the claim. If the respondent files any counterclaim, then there is another procedure for that, for eventually ending up with the respondent filing a rejoinder to the counterclaim, if any. Then parties are allowed to, they're open to file applications for inspection of documents, for discovery and production, so on and so forth. They are required to exchange a draft list of issues so that the tribunal will decide that these are the things for which the arbitration has been commenced, and these are the things on which the tribunal is required to apply their mind and provide an award. Admission and denial of documents is also a procedure that is followed in most ad hoc documents. And if the parties or the tribunal have agreed to use the IBA rules of evidence, then they are required to adhere to all the requirements that are set out over there. In document requests, for example, that is done through a red fern schedule, which due to paucity of time, we can't go into the details of the red fern schedule, but maybe we can discuss that at some other time. Time will also be provided for parties to raise objections. They say that we don't want to produce certain documents. They will note the objections and tribunal will rule whether this objection is plausible, if it is not plausible, or upheld. In case the objection is not upheld, then the party must produce those documents. So time will be given for producing those documents. Well, various reasons could be there for taking up an objection. You can check the IBA rules for what is said over there. But most commonly, for example, the document is completely confidential and not relevant to the proceedings, so on and so forth. So I do not want to produce the document. But if the tribunal decides otherwise, you will still have to produce it within the time period. Then, of course, you would have to file the evidence in chief. After you have identified your witness or witnesses, you have to file the evidence in chief. Chief examination is done by way of affidavit. You do not have to do an oral examination for examination in chief. Then you would come to the stage of cross-examining of both witnesses, both fact witnesses as well as expert witnesses in case there are any. Then we move on to opening arguments and eventually to final arguments. If we can go to the next slide. Now there are various applications that can be filed during the course of the arbitration itself. So one, of course, is in case you are not happy or that there is a challenge that you can make to the arbitrator herself, then you file that application before the tribunal. The norm is that you file the challenge before the tribunal, and the exception is that you file the challenge before the court. Then you also have the right as a respondent, mostly, of course, to challenge the jurisdiction of the tribunal. jurisdiction can be challenged on various grounds. For example, there is no arbitration agreement at all, the contract is invalid, or that the arbitration agreement entered into is invalid, or the tribunal has exceeded its scope of jurisdiction because this kind of a dispute was not meant to be referred to arbitration, so on and so forth. And as we discussed in relation to Section 9, the same reliefs can be sought from the tribunal itself. If the relief cannot be sought before the tribunal, only then the court would generally go and grant it under Section 9. But once the arbitration has commenced, then the court will very, very rarely issue any relief under Section 9, because you have the opportunity of going to the arbitral tribunal. Now, I can see that the time is now coming to an end here. So let's take a break, get back to the remaining. So I can see the slide over here on the other link also, if you can go to the next slide. Okay, great. So like we discussed, one of the things that have to be filed is the chief evidence. We'll discuss chief examination and cross-examination in very brief. The couple of things that you should keep in mind. Firstly, when you're choosing your witness, firstly choose your witness very carefully. Because what I mean by that is that when the client comes to you, the client is from a company or organization otherwise, the legal officer will approach you, and that person will be provided other data from the people in the company itself, which would be from the business team and so on and so forth. No? So it is important that you present your witness, such a witness who has personally experienced whatever problem has arisen between the parties. So, and this choice should, if possible, ideally be made before you file the pleadings. The reason is you should know beforehand, you should talk to the witness beforehand as to what all that person has experienced in relation to this transaction, in relation to the breach, whatever correspondence has been had. Because sometimes, even though it may appear that in arbitration proceedings, everything is about documents, correspondence is also most times written, but there are a lot of things in which your witness evidence could be the linchpin. Because, for instance, if there is a claim from you or from the other side that parties, despite having the contract, the parties have entered into certain negotiations or certain settlements that the respondent may claim that no, the claimant actually provided certain relaxations. There were certain extensions granted. These extensions were granted by the claimant's officers on phone call, so on and so forth. For these kind of things also, you require the witness, and even otherwise to support the facts that you are pleading in the case. Therefore, while preparing the pleading only, it's better to have the witness identified. When you're preparing the pleading, you should make it in line with what the witness is going to say. And similarly, when after having prepared the pleadings, when you're preparing the affidavit of evidence, firstly, one must also realize that it is not a legal arguments, that it's not the legal arguments that you are putting out in the witness evidence. But whatever is being stated, it should be consistent with what you have said in the pleadings. If there is inconsistency in the affidavit of evidence and the pleadings that you have filed, then that will be a major issue for you to be ripped apart in the cross-examination. Also, another thing is for you to make sure that you have the optimum number of witnesses. It should not be, one should not think that you have five witnesses, that is going to make your case much better. In fact, that would be a problem, because five different witnesses filing the similar kind of evidence may still have a chance of contradicting each other at the time of cross-examination. Now, if there are two witnesses who are giving evidence about the same thing, but in cross they say two different things, then you are going to be in doldrums. That's going to be a problem. So always better to have the fewest possible witnesses. Then moving on to the contents itself of a witness statement, as we discussed previously, it's not supposed to have legal arguments or otherwise claims of breach or so on and so forth.
Structurally speaking, it would first carry the introduction, say introduce the person, who is that person, how, where, address and designation of that person, what kind of relationship that person shares with the organization, in what capacity the witness was involved in the transaction at hand, right? Because we have to show that this person has had first-hand experience to whatever that person is talking about. Then we go on to the crux of the matter. This would be a factual narrative saying that, for example, on such and such day, we entered into negotiations with the other party. Then we drew up a contract. After the contract was drawn up, it was decided that such and such things will be taken into consideration, that such and such things would be performed at such and such times, so on and so forth. Ideally, the witness should not give evidence or even be crossed about the exact contents of the document unless it is a matter that is open to interpretation. Okay. The witness testimony has to be clear and concise, like all other documents. There is no need to go on a rant about everything that has been done, right, on a tirade. Eventually, you would, of course, have to adhere to the formal requirements that have been set out by the applicable law of evidence or directions of evidence that the tribunal has given you. It would be required to be, the witness statement needs to be signed and affirmed by the witness. And if required, it has to also be notarized in case it's an affidavit. We can go to the next slide. Now, there are, before we go on to cross-examination, there is also the matter of two different kind of witnesses, broadly speaking. One is a witness of fact and the other is a witness of expertise or an expert witness. You may require expert witnesses in several kind of situations. One that I can think of is where in a shareholder's agreement, where one of the party is asserting its right to exit the company or under the shareholder's agreement. While exiting, that party would have to be paid, say, the fair market value of the shares that that party is holding. So the claimant will say that I need to be paid the fair market value of the shares. Now, deriving the fair market value is an inexact science. And what the parties would generally agree is that the fair market value would be what is determined by one of the big four firms or accounting firms or any of the accounting firms. So now both the respondent as well as the claimant will bring expert evidence. They will appoint say PwC or any other big four accounting firm, Grant Thornton, etc., to say that according to us, the fair market value is this. Now remember, the expert evidence is not supposed to be biased. It is supposed to be as per their norms. The expert is required to say that in our assessment, based on whatever values that we have used, whatever principles and methodology that we are supposed to use, based on that, this is the fair value. And then the tribunal will decide whether and which expert has presented the better fair value or the more realistic fair value based on the evidence that has been led. Both witnesses of fact and witnesses of expertise will be cross-examined. You will have an opportunity to cross-examine both witnesses. In cross-examination, one of the golden rules, or rather the golden rule, is that you should really not ask questions to whose answer you don't already know, because you don't want to be exposed to something or be caught by surprise where your own case will be contradicted. So this, of course, now even I'm saying, but it requires a lot of planning and a lot of experience to be able to know what questions you should ask. And that is something that you will, of course, derive from your own experiences. Seemingly obvious is that you should ask leading questions. They should be as tight as possible, in the sense that you should, when you're asking the question itself, you should not keep a lot of leeway for the other side to answer in anything but yes or no, or perhaps I don't know. But beyond that, it should not allow the witness, the question should not allow the witness to go on a, kind of a story. No, this did not happen, but this is something that I was considering at that point of time, and so forth. Of course, despite all your efforts, the witness may do that. That is something that you can request the tribunal to strike off, or that is something that you can deal with at the time of final arguments. You should not ask open-ended questions, which is, as I said, is basically the opposite of the second point, is that in case you are asking the question, your line of questioning is that whether there was any innovation of their settlement. Instead of asking that, you know, on such and such day, did you make a call to such and such person? This is mostly a close-ended question. But if you ask the person that, oh, please explain the kind of negotiation techniques that you have applied, then that person will be able to go on to a completely, that person will have a free rein to speak whatever that comes to that person's mind. So you should again keep it tight. The last thing is something that is, it's debatable whether it has to be done. But I would say that, yes, it is something that can be done. Is once you're at the end of one line of questioning and you reach the culmination point of whatever you're trying to achieve through this questioning, you put your case to the client, the witness. You put your case to the witness, say that I put it to you that based on whatever you have answered, there has been a breach of contract by your client, by the respondent. You want to make one. This is something that you'll use in final arguments. We can go to the next one. Now, this is perhaps the last one. And if we can also go to the next one on the other link. So, see, opening and final arguments are the last stage of the arbitral process during the arbitration process. And there, as we saw in the schedule, there will be time allotted for opening and final arguments. In opening arguments, you just have to make out the case of what you are supposed to argue. You are going to set out a base. It's again should not be a long tirade of what you want to say. In the final arguments, which is one of the most important things, before the final arguments, most probably the tribunal will ask you to prepare written submissions as also a compilation of all the things that you are going to write. You can't expect the tribunal to go through every single thing and every single of whatever has been filed. So it is incumbent on you, even if the tribunal does not say, to prepare a certain kind of convenience compilation to highlight only the main documents, bring them all together, collate them and present it to the tribunal as also the others. Then in the actual final arguments, as also which will be relied upon through the witness, through the written submissions, what you will essentially do is a chemical exercise, if I may say so. You have to bring all your pleadings together, the witness statements, whatever has been said by the other side, the data that you've derived from the cross-examination, the differences that you can highlight from the case that the other side has made. You have to show the strength of your arguments, of your case, based on the weakness of the other side, which all of this you will get from a complete reading and a cohesive reading of all that has been filed as well as from the cross-examination. This, of course, will have to be supplemented by the legal arguments, the case law that you are going to rely upon. And all this brought together will make your written submissions. And based on that, you will make a final. Now, that's about it. So if we can go to the questions now. If there are any questions at this point of time, we can address them. Okay, so there is one question from Priyanka, which I said we'll take later. Sir, as stated by you, the arbitral proceedings shall commence upon issues of notice for its initiation by the claimant. What if the respondent does not revert within the stipulated period? How would the proceedings commence then? As the parties can opt for arbitration mutually and abiding by the clause that the award shall be binding on the parties. Yes, that's absolutely fair. The what happens is that most likely the respondent will not adhere to what you are saying or perform its obligation of appointing an arbitrator. In such a case, you can apply to the court under Section 11 and request the court to appoint an arbitrator for on behalf of the respondent. Once that arbitrator has been appointed, those two arbitrators, which is your nominee and the arbitrator that has been appointed by the court, these two people will come together and appoint the presiding arbitrator. But so that way your tribunal will be constituted. If it's a sole arbitrator arbitration, then you have to simply ask for the appointment of a sole arbitrator, which can be done. Okay, so in case where the arbitration proceedings have already begun and one party has objection against an arbitrator, then what is the remedy available to such a party? Will the objection be addressed only after the award has been passed? So, no. As a matter of fact, under in this kind of ad hoc arbitration and an arbitration seated in India otherwise, you have provisions under Section 12 and 13 of the Arbitration Act, where you can challenge the appointment of an arbitrator on the specific grounds that are set in those provisions, which would mainly be if there is any conflict of interest or if you can show that there is an apparent lack of independence or impartiality. If the arbitration has already commenced and you have reached an advanced stage, I think the section provides that you have to raise an objection at the time that you become aware of it. If you forego it, then you will not be able to raise that objection. Another thing, for example, is if you are the claimant, right? If you are the claimant, you have only appointed an arbitrator, and after that you find out that there is certain some kind of conflict of interest, then unless you came to know about it at that very point of time, you will not be able to challenge, right? But yes, you can obviously, the provision exists. You can challenge the appointment of an arbitrator during the arbitration process. There's a question for yesterday's session, which is the difference between the venue and place of arbitration. Now, as we discussed yesterday, the mainly what it means is that you will have to first look at the semantics of the agreement itself. If the parties provide that there is going to be a venue shall be at Mumbai or venue shall be Mumbai, India, and there is nothing else to provide about the seat of the arbitration, then the court is going to presume that the venue itself is the seat of arbitration. But when there are two different things, seat of arbitration is Mumbai, for example, and venue is another place within Mumbai, then the seat is India, because of which the Arbitration Act applies, part one of the Arbitration Act applies. The seat carries with it, seat or place carries with it, the laws that are in that particular geographical location. And venue, juxtaposed with the seat, is the geographical location where or convenient place where meetings of arbitration will be held. That is the essential difference. The seat brings the law and the venue is the physical place where you have to, the place where you have physical meetings. That is essentially what difference is. There is another question. So there is another question if for objections that are to be raised in front of the court. Now, if you see Section 14 of the Arbitration Act, then that will provide that when an arbitrator has become legally or factually impossible to act during the course of the arbitration, such questions are supposed to be referred to the court. These kind of objections for challenging the arbitrator, you can file before the court under Section 15. Also, if there is an objection under 12.7 of the Arbitration Act, if there is a conflict which provides that because such a conflict exists, the arbitrator could never have been appointed in the first place, then you can apply before the court itself and not have to go through the process of an arbitral application. Because what happens is, if you file the application before the tribunal itself and the tribunal says that, or the arbitrator says that, I am not conflicted, okay, then you have to go through the arbitration proceedings and you will have another chance only during the time of setting aside the arbitral award. Okay, Palak has a question which says that what according to you would be the effect of insolvency proceedings commenced in India where moratorium has been imposed already in an international commercial arbitration seated outside India? That is an interesting question. Now, see, the Insolvency Act technically, or Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, has application in and across India. So if there is an arbitration proceeding that is commenced and foreign seated arbitration, essentially, I am not sure why the moratorium period should apply to such kind of an arbitration. But honestly, this is something that I'll have to also look at, and I'll get back to you on this. Okay. So this is the last question that I'll take right now. Sir, do the parties have to name or appoint the arbitrators in the agreement itself, or they can just mention that an arbitrator will be appointed when the dispute arises? They can appoint someone. Absolutely. So you are not required to, as a matter of law, you're not required to set out the number of arbitrators or the manner of appointing the arbitrator. But it is always recommended that you set out how many arbitrators you want and how they are supposed to be appointed. But you may also set out in the agreement that arbitrator will be appointed when the dispute commences. If there is nothing else that is provided in the agreement, if there is no procedure for both the parties to appoint an arbitrator, then you have to mandatorily go before the court and seek appointment of the arbitrator. Has Supreme Court of India put an end to one party appointed sole arbitrator system? Yes, that is true. Where any arbitration clause provides that only one of the parties will appoint the sole arbitrator, the Supreme Court has said in Perkins Eastman versus HPCC, a judgment of 2019 December, I think, where Supreme Court has said that such a clause is not enforceable because it carries bias, which means that one of the parties will be able to direct the proceedings and have an unfair advantage. And therefore, such a clause is not enforceable as the law currently prevails. Okay, I think we are done with the questions. So thank you all for joining once again. And I'll see you all tomorrow for the last session. Thanks all. Again, see you tomorrow.